Humans have been domesticating plants for almost 12,000 years. But a new wave of domestication is just beginning, this time in labs rather than in fields. Following the footsteps of our ancestors, those ancient genetic engineers, we're designing the crops today that will feed humanity in the future. Welcome to the genetic basis of stuff and things. Say you had a field of tomatoes, growing in all different sizes, but you liked the big ones the best. What would you do? Easy, you might say. Grow only the seed from the biggest tomatoes, and next year, all the tomatoes will be bigger. Perfect. Now do it for millennia. Over that kind of timescale, this technique becomes extraordinarily powerful. Early farmers used it to create the foods we know today, many of them from a starting point we'd barely recognize. But in the pursuit of yield, they also lost things. They could only select for traits they could easily see, so they inadvertently bred crops that were less nutritious and less stress-resistant. Also, by allowing only the very best crops in each generation to reproduce, they lost genetic diversity. This makes everything consistent and reliable, but also, if one plant gets sick, they all get sick, and they can't handle changing conditions. Now that it's too late, we can see our mistakes. Our climate is changing, and those qualities we bred out of our food crops are becoming increasingly important. But now that they're gone, we can't get them back, not without starting over. But that's impossible, right? Wrong! Not 12,000 BC anymore, this is the modern age. We can sequence a genome in minutes. We can edit targeted gene sequences as easily as baking a pie. So this'll be easy, right? Wrong again! Knowing the raw genome sequence and being able to edit it is only part of the puzzle. We can't yet look at a sequence of A's, C's, G's, and T's and predict what it does. We can read the letters, but we don't speak the language. Identifying genes and their purposes takes a lot of work, but it can be done. Let's go back to that tomato example. If we want to find out which genes are responsible for size, we'll need two tomatoes as different in size as possible. We'll create a map of the genetic differences between them, focusing on points where the difference is present on both of a pair of chromosomes. We'll try and find as many of these as possible. The denser the map, the more accurately we can locate a gene. After the map's complete, we'll cross the two plants together, then cross their offspring with each other. The resulting grandchildren will range widely in size and have many different combinations of their grandparents' genes. We'll measure and genotype all of these tomatoes. For each point on our map, called a marker, there are three possible genotypes. We'll compare the size of the tomatoes across these three genotypes. If they're all similar, then that marker is not associated with the size gene. If they're significantly different, then that marker is associated with the size gene. However, this does not mean that the marker is part of the gene, only that it is close to it and often inherited along with it. Studies like this provide us with a starting point for where a gene might be. After a likely position is identified, researchers use an advanced technique called trial and error to find a gene. They transplant pieces of DNA from one parent into the other one, piece by piece, until a change in size is observed. When it is, they've found the gene. These methods have allowed us to find genes for fruit size, number, shape, nutrient composition, and more in tomatoes and other crops. But it's a lot harder to find a gene for stress resistance. We run into the same old problem with traits we can't easily see or measure. So what now? Is it over? Well, no. The solution lies in working backwards. Instead of adding stress-resistance genes to modern tomatoes, we can add domestication genes into wild tomatoes, which are already stress-resistant. This creates the same final result, but with a lot less fuss. Clever, right? This process, called de novo domestication, was first done in 2018 by Agustin Zsögön and Tomáš Čermák. They successfully edited five domestication alleles into Solanum pimpinellifolium, the wild relative of the modern tomato, recreating thousands of years of domestication in a single experiment. First, they increased the size of the wild tomato by breaking a gene called fasciated, which acts during flower development to restrict the number of carpels. Each carpel develops into a segment of the final tomato. Breaking this gene produced a faceted flower which grew into a large and many-segmented fruit. But with this change alone, the plant would still be producing only a few fruits every now and then. So they changed another gene called multiflora. This gene regulates the development of floral inflorescences. Breaking it caused another inflorescence to sprout in place of each flower, leading to many more fruit. Next, they edited the genes self-pruning and ovate. Self-pruning is expressed in the tip of the growing plant, telling it when to sprout leaves and flowers. Breaking it converted a vine that grew continuously into a bush whose fruit ripened all at once. This is essential for mechanical harvest. Ovate codes for a growth inhibitor that is expressed in the neck of the developing fruit. Breaking this gene removed the inhibitor, causing the fruit to become pear-shaped.
But there was still something missing. Right, they should be redder than that. The final change was to a gene called lycopene beta cyclase, which codes for an enzyme that turns lycopene, an important nutrient, and a source of flavor and red color in tomatoes, into a different molecule. By breaking the gene, They removed the enzyme and caused lycopene to accumulate. This led to a deep red fruit that was tasty and nutritious.
With this study, Zsögön and Čermák proved that gene editing can be used to re-domesticate crops quickly and effectively, while retaining the genetic diversity and stress-resistance traits that were lost the first time around. Because of this work, de novo domestication will be an important strategy in the future, allowing us to maintain food security as the climate changes.
But perhaps the most important lesson in this story comes from the unique approach. When faced with an impossible problem, like finding a stress-resistance gene or preparing crops for our future, perhaps the best approach is backwards. After all, if you want to find something you lost, you should probably retrace your steps.